Speaking of corruption, money, all of that at the highest level, let's move on. The Maxwell trial. We've had a first couple of days of what's been happening there. No bombshell revelations necessarily at the top, but more a lot of confirmation of what we already knew. The biggest accusation, actually, that we saw for the very first time, let's put this up there on the screen. The first alleged victim called in the trial, testifying anonymously, by the way, of Ghislaine Maxwell, has testified under cross-examination that Epstein actually took her to Mar-a-Lago when she was 14 years old to meet Donald Trump. To be clear, she did not allege any improper behavior by Trump or characterize the meeting, but this pairs with the fact that this trial is just revealing the depths of which Ghislaine Maxwell and which Jeffrey Epstein cavorted with some of the most famous and richest people on the planet. Their pilot of Jeffrey Epstein's Lolita Express, a picture of which was actually released recently, they went out and said that he's like, look, I've seen people like Donald Trump, Bill Clinton, Prince Andrew, celebrities, Kevin Spacey on the plane. And he said, look, I've never seen any improper, you know, sexual behavior or whatever, but I saw a lot of young women. I saw a lot of these famous people on the plane.
Well, he claimed he thought everybody was of age on the plane, too.
That's
definitely covering his butt as well.
Yeah, he's covering his ass. Mm-hmm. And we actually already know from the past that Epstein forced some of these young girls to actually dress up in flight attendants' uniforms in order to get them on the plane and fly them all around the world. And one of those women actually was photographed giving a massage to Bill Clinton in an airport terminal. So at the direction actually of Ghislaine Maxwell. Also important though for other cases is that he did testify that he had seen Virginia Giuffre, one of the most prominent Epstein accusers, on the plane. So this testimony could actually back up not only her accusations against Maxwell, but in her civil case against Prince Andrew, which in my opinion, those are the much more significant ones. I mean, it's very difficult here because also I didn't know this, but James Comey's daughter is the woman who's prosecuting Maxwell.
Oh, really?
Yes, she's the lead prosecutor on behalf of the Department of Justice. Yeah, small world, I guess. And one of the problems, though, is that they are charging her with crimes from the 1999 and then 2004. And a lot of Epstein's connections, I'm not saying all of them, with the richest and most powerful, the most problematic ones, actually came after he was convicted as a sex offender because, A, it was already known that he was a sex offender, and B, that's when he started getting involved with the Israeli prime minister, Ehud Barak, Bill Clinton, obviously, Hillary, and then we know also, you know, in terms of Bill Gates, all that relationship, that was post-sex offender conviction, Leon Black. That is when Deutsche Bank being fined, having known of his involvement and his past sexual offender history. That's when some of the most nefarious conduct, from what I can see, that he was engaged in, actually is when it all began to happen. So, look, we have a tear sheet. Let's put this up there. And to the actual accusation, the very first day of testimony, the anonymous accuser, her name is Jane, testified that Ghislaine Maxwell and Epstein sexually abused her when she was 14. The key, though, in a lot of this for the Maxwell defense is that they allege that Maxwell is on trial for the crimes of Epstein. They're like, look, we agree. Epstein was a sex offender. Epstein was doing all this. But Ghislaine Maxwell never participated in any of it. But per the testimony and more, she was not only sexually abused by Jeffrey Epstein, but Ghislaine Maxwell both procured her, groomed her, and in some cases, actually participated in the sexual assault herself.
Yeah.
She's no victim.
The stories, the story of this Jane Doe accuser. It's horrible. She's 14 years old. She sees this couple. She's at this sort of like exclusive private school in Michigan, the Interlochen School. And they approach her very friendly. And also, her father had died. And her mom had fallen on difficult financial times. So they're preying on someone who's not only a young girl, but in a very vulnerable situation. And over time, she describes the way that she's groomed by Ghislaine, which to me, I mean, that whole process is almost as disgusting as the act itself. And then, but not only that, she then is participating in the actual abuse. So, yeah, I mean, it's stunning. And the defense's approach is to basically smear these women. Mm-hmm. Say they're fame seekers. Say they're just looking for money.
How can you be a fame seeker when you're anonymous?
Right. Say that, you know, as you said, that, oh, Ghislaine's being persecuted for the crimes of this man, and turn it into almost like a gender or feminist kind of an argument. Given the amount of evidence that it looks like they're going to be able to marshal, I think it's pretty unlikely that that is going to work. But there's a couple things that always come to mind. I mean, first of all, why is this important? It's because of how they were able to operate for so long with all of these people in elite circles, just even after he'd been convicted as a sex offender and is on the list. There's still, you know, Bill Gates and Bill Clinton and Donald Trump and all of them happy to associate with him.
That's the main story to me. Always will be.
100%. And the other part of this is Ghislaine deserves to spend the rest of her life in prison based on the allegations that we know. But there were a lot of other people who were involved. Where are those charges? You know, where's going to be the accountability for all of the many people who were involved either in the abuse or in facilitating this? There is one part of this that's a little bit funny, which is that QAnon, which is very interested in child sex trafficking, they've been very upset by the fact that Trump not only did this accuser say, you know, she was brought to Mar-a-Lago at 14, but also that he was on the plane multiple times, which is against what, you know, had been said in the past. So QAnon is in overdrive trying to spin and defend Trump.
Yeah, of course.
Because their whole thing is like, oh, there's this cabal of, you know, criminal sex traffickers, but they're all Democrats.
I was saying, true, they exist. They are not all Democrats.
So they're trying to spin in real time what's going on here, apparently, which is kind of funny.
It is interesting. I mean, my disappointment with this trial is always that, like I said, I don't understand why the DOJ is only prosecuting on these old crimes from 99 and 2004. From what I have read, the concern is if they do it after he was accused and had that deal with federal prosecutors, there could be some, not double jeopardy necessarily, but some stuff would come out about their own role in giving Epstein that sweetheart deal in the first place, deciding not to prosecute him federally, turning him over to Palm Beach Prison. So that's why they brought what they considered to be rock solid charges from 99 and 2004. The problem, like I said, is that the real juice, like so to speak, all happens after he gets accused of being a sex offender.
The elite connections are.
Exactly. Well, that's when Epstein needed them more than ever, right? That's when he was both a sex offender. And he was like, I need to launder my reputation. That's when he got involved with the MIT, what was it? MIT School of Journal, Media Lab or whatever.
Yeah.
And Joy Ito. And he was giving him anonymous dollars and meeting with all these scientists. You know, I've talked with Lex Fridman before. And Lex Fridman actually knows scientists who met Epstein. And they were like, oh, he's, you know, purported to be very interested in their work. You know, I mean, that is when the real machine kind of kicked in to high gear. And when people like Bill Gates and them were willing to cast aside the known fact that he was a sex offender and associate with him anyway, in many cases, hang out with him like we've been learning from the past. So
I mean, in that Katie Couric book, that's the era when she's being brought into these meetings, which are clearly about getting connections with the press so that they're, you know, he's able to get positive coverage or no coverage at all.
That dinner was crazy because it was like Katie Couric, George Stephanopoulos, and a few all at the Epstein mansion, you know, right there in downtown in New York City. And yeah, you consider that, the fact that the Israeli prime minister just happened to, you know, stay there all the time for had no reason, he had Epstein as an investor in his company, you know, the neighbors saw him staying there all the time. And those are the parts where I am the most interested in and where I think, I hope that we'll learn a little bit more. But unfortunately, I mean, look, at the same time, can't erase the problems of the victims, but the international conspiracy and all that, not a lot of that is coming out of this trial.
Not so far. Hey guys, thanks so much for watching.
That's right. Just as a reminder, you can become a premium subscriber today. Watch the full show completely uncut, our reactions to each other's monologues. You get to listen to it. You get to ask us questions, all that good stuff. Link is right there in the description or at breakingpoints.com.
Best of all, great way to say screw you to the mainstream media.